Welcome viewers, I'm Mamta. Today we are taking up chapter 3 of class 12 psychology. This carries 7 marks weightage according to CBSE. The name of the chapter is Human Strengths and Life Challenges. Now, if I ask you a question when you're going for an exam or if you're going for an interview, what are the sensations, the feelings, the symptoms that you're experiencing before you appear for that particular situation? Now, for the same situation, 4 different people are going to give different responses. That is what we call as stress, the reaction of an individual to a particular situation, which basically determines the coping style, the resources the person has, and which can also disturb the equilibrium or the balance in the body. Now, do you think all kind of stress is bad? Because we keep talking about this concept of stress, you hear it so often, and people every time feel that they are stressed out. But do you think it is good also in any way, or is it all bad? Now, researchers have said that, you know, a lot of times when, let's say when we are studying for an exam, that time if the level of our stress is average according to our capacity, if it is optimal according to our capacity, it is considered good also. This is known as eustress. So the stress which helps you attain your maximum and best performance, which helps you deal with crisis situation, which energizes you and gives you so much energy to deal with that particular situation. This is known as eustress. On the other hand, the stress which limits you, which affects you negatively, which results in a disturbance in the equilibrium, which results in a wear and tear in your body, is known as a distress. Now, these are the 2 major concepts, along with which we come to the starting point of stress concept. It was taken from a Latin word, strictus, which means to tighten. So whenever somebody experiences stress, they feel a lot of discomfort in the body. That's the internal disturbance or the tight feeling or the narrow feeling. Then we have another concept related to it, which is known as stressor. Another one is strain. Now, stressor is any outside event to which a person responds. So outside event is a stressor. The person's reaction is known as a strain. Now, we have one more very important definition of stress, which through which the definition and the concept of stress started. This was Hans Selye's, who is the father of modern stress research, according to whom stress is a non-specific reaction of an individual to a situation. Now, non-specific means it's very general. So every emotion, every situation, it's going to be the same reaction. But normally, if you look at it, it doesn't happen that way. If I'm angry, my reaction will be different. In case of any other emotion, when I'm stressed out, my reaction will be different. So, criticizing this concept, we moved on to the concept of Lazarus, which is known as the appraisal concept. Now, appraisal means the way I look at a situation, the way I perceive a situation. So, same situation, different people will look at it in a different manner. It's like the color of my lens, or it's like the way I'm looking, what is my frame of reference in my mirror through which I'm looking. It could be my past experience which determines this. It could be some other factor which determines it. That's what we're looking at right now. Now, the concept of appraisal is divided into 2 parts, primary appraisal and secondary appraisal. Primary appraisal refers to the perception of a new or changing environment, that is, whatever outside environment is changing, either as positive, negative, or neutral in consequence. Now, this is again our perception, our interpretation of the outside situation, whether we look at it in terms of positive, having a positive consequence, or we look at it in terms of negative. So this is of importance here. Negative would mean any kind of harm, threat, or challenge. Harm is the damage which is already done. Threat is a future damage that we are perceiving it to be, any situation having a future damage that we think it to be. And challenge is kind of an opportunity that we are looking at it as, what we can prove in that particular situation, what kind of, you know, success we can get out of that particular situation. Now, once this appraisal is done, the primary appraisal, particularly the negative one, we move on to the second part of it, which is known as a secondary appraisal. Now, once we know that the situation is going to be harmful or threatening or is a challenge, then we try to look at what kind of resources or abilities we are having here. So those situations, those abilities, those particular skills help us deal with that appraisal. So that is the concept of secondary appraisal here. To understand this concept of appraisal, once we've done the secondary appraisal, we have 3 major aspects under it to help us understand it holistically. Now, first is the kind of stressors that a person is experiencing. So outside events which result in our body giving a response, it could be the intensity, that is a type of a stressor, which could be the intensity of it, how much high or low that event is, the duration of it, that is for how long that particular event has been, the controllability of it, that is that event under my control? Suppose there's noise coming from the background when I'm studying. Is it under my control? What all can I do to handle that particular situation is the controllability. Last type of stressor is a predictability, which means that do I know that this particular situation is bound to happen? Then I am kind of prepared for it. If I do not know, it's all of a sudden somebody dies in a family. All of a sudden, when you're not prepared for it, then your reaction is very, very much stressful. That particular situation is highly stressful. So if the duration is for long, intensity is very high, predictability is low, and controllability is low, stress is going to be very, very high. The second kind of appraisal, the second kind of factor which results in appraisal is talking about the person's characteristics. Now here we're talking about the physical characteristics of the person, the psychological, as well as the social and environmental factors. So which we call as the cultural factors. So when we talk about the physical factors per se, we talk about the health of a person, the physical health. So for instance, a particular child, you know, starts having a stomach ache just before the exam. So that's a physical symptom that the body is showing because the stomach is the weakest area for that particular person. So that way as a person constitutionally the person's stomach is very weak. A particular person, you know, starts having viral very frequently. So misses school for that reason or misses workplace for that reason. High absenteeism is there. That's another factor which is counted on here and in the physical health area. Second factor we have is the psychological characteristics. Here we talk about the mental health of a person, the confidence of a person, the way a person perceives a situation. Suppose a person feels that, you know, a particular maths problem is given for solving out, and this person says that I can solve that particular problem. So for this person, the self-concept is high because every situation the person is getting across, the person has the feeling, has the faith and the ability that I can handle this particular situation. Somebody criticizes you. Your reaction could be to get defensive, that okay, I did not do it, please don't misunderstand me. The other could be that maybe there is some element of truth in it, let me reconsider, let me think about it and not feel negative about it. So this is your perception again based on your qualities, the way your mental health is. Do you tend to get into worry and anxiety very easily or do you tend to analyze it in a positive manner? That's the psychological characteristics. Then we have the third concept, which is the culture. Now, culture again determines your perception because in one particular culture, it will depend on what do people say. So a particular culture, for that particular culture, the outside forces matter a lot. For the other culture, it would be what is my success? What do I want to do? So that's again the cultural concept in appraising a particular situation. So third concept that we have is the concept of resources, which helps us appraise a particular situation. Resources in terms of the physical resources that we have, that is money that we have or the health factors that we have, the medical care. It could be the personal factors, the skills that a person has, the coping abilities that a person has. Third factor also considers the first two along with it. And this is also one kind of resource, which is society related resource. Social support, what kind of family network, what kind of relations a person has, which helps a person at the time of stressful situation. So these three factors, including the stressors that a person experiences, the qualities a person has, and the resources the person has to handle a particular situation, determines appraisal. Now moving on to the concept of signs and symptoms as to how to identify if a person is having stress. Because most of the time, stress goes undiagnosed. Nobody really realizes they are under stress till the time they go for a particular vacation or they take a break. Now, to identify stress, we have a lot of categories of symptoms. It deals with the physiological symptoms, that is what happens in the body. Because most of the time when the hormones are released in a stressful situation, the first damage is to the body. So body systems get affected, but that's a gradual process, so people normally don't realize it. Then we have the cognitive, which are the major factors through which stress can be identified. That's the very quickest and easy to identify. A person is not able to concentrate. A person forgets. A person is not able to make proper decisions. A person is not able to use rational thinking. So all these aspects result in the cognitive aspect of that is how we identify the stress. We also have the behavioral aspect. Sometimes people are not able to, you know, have any appetite. So they are not able to eat properly. They're not able to sleep properly. So eating and sleeping is affected. People tend to go in for drugs or any addiction, any substances. Watching TV is also an addiction. Or they get into book reading as an escape. They tend to cry a lot, get very irritable, mood swings are there. All these are symptoms, worry, anxiety, fear, all these are symptoms which help us identify that a person is stressed out and needs a break. Now, moving on to the next topic, what are the different kinds of stress that are there? What are the different kinds of stressors which are there? First kind of stressors are the physical and environmental stressors. Physical, dealing with body stress, suppose a person overexerts. So more than your capacity you are working physically, it could be playing a lot for, let's say, a number of hours. It could be physical labor that a person does, a daily wager does. That's a physical stress which exerts the body. Second is environmental stress. Now, this stress could either be a general environment, a lot of noise which irritates a person, getting into a particular place and it's very crowded, so the person feels stressed out, very, very uncomfortable. It could also be normal heat pollution, which could result in road rage. A temperature, high temperature could result in a road rage. And it could be a major environmental stressor, like a traumatic situation. Any earthquake, any robbery, a major traumatic situation of the environment can be environmental stressor. Second type of stressor that we have is a psychological factor, psychological stressor. Under this, which is an internal stressor that we create within ourselves, it's a personal stressor, which is only to the person experiencing it. For somebody else, it may not apply. So under this, we have three categories. First is frustration. Frustration is referring to any particular goal which is blocked. So I want to top the exam, but by 1% I left out on the second position, or I'm not able to get into a particular college which I desired. So whatever goal I had, there's a block in that particular goal, and this is what we call as frustration. Second is a conflict. Now, there can be incompatible needs or motives. There can be two goals, two choices that I'm given with. Should I take up humanities or should I take up commerce with maths? These are the two choices. Should I study right now or should I go out for a movie with my friends? So these are the choices that a person gets. So based on the choices that you make, results in a conflict resolution or a conflict which continues. Third factor is known as the pressure factor. Now, pressure could be internal, my own expectations from myself. When I am working hard, I expect to achieve a certain level of performance. That's an internal pressure where I have a certain belief and I want to accomplish that. A second part of it is social pressure. Social pressure refers to the kind of expectation the society has from a particular person. So what society values and we want to do that, that's a social pressure. Now, third kind of stressor that we have is a social stressor. Here we're talking about the major changes in life which, you know, result in an upheaval in the person's life. For instance, death of a family member, chronic illness, any kind of strained relationships which result in a stress in the social situation. Last topic for today that we have is the sources of stress. Now, there are three major sources of stress that we have to cover. First source of stress is the life events. Now, these are the changes, small or big, which results in a person's routine change. So the normal routine of a person gets disturbed. It could be shifting a house. It could be a break in a friendship or a misunderstanding in a relationship. All that is a life event. It could be neighbors which are not very healthy. All that can result in life event stressor. Second source of stress is the daily hassles. Now, these are particularly insignificant, but when they add on in everyday life, they ultimately result in a lot of stress. So daily hassles could mean that for a housewife, you know, small changes in the family setup or small emergency situation that she has to handle, that could be daily hassles. For a child who's going to school, getting up in the morning, if he gets late, misses his bus, gets late for the exam, all of that is a daily hassle. Getting stuck up in a traffic jam is a daily hassle. So when they accumulate, when they add on, it results in a lot of stress. Now the third factor, the third source of stress is the traumatic events. The major traumas that a person goes through, it could be a mass trauma or the trauma in the life of a person, which turns around a person's life and is a major cause of stress for a long period. It could be a fire, an accident, a robbery in the family. It could be any natural disaster. Now that results in a lot of changes in the perception of a person. The person can tend to get very negative. The person can lose hope. The person gets very irritable and frustrated and doesn't know what to do. So all such aspects can also be a major source of stress. Now, under this, Holmes and Rahe have done a research which deals with 51 life stressors that they presented to the participants, and they try to understand how much stress a particular event causes to that person. That was for a self-rating scale. To summarize for today, we understood the concept of human strengths and virtues, positive aspects that we have that help us deal and cope with various situations. From there, we moved on to the concept of adaptation and adjustment to understand how it helps us in dealing with situations. And then we understood the concept of stress and the various signs and symptoms, the different types of stress, the concept of appraisal. And then we summarized the sources of stress. That's about it for today. Thank you.